Good morning. Welcome to worship. And happy Mother's Day. Just a few reminders for you. Adult Life continues on Wednesday nights. That's being led by Greg and Barb Lamping, and that goes from 6 to 7 p.m. And that will continue through May 24th. The Baby Bottle Fundraiser, raising funds for the Hope Life Center, is going to run through May 28th. Again, if you haven't already grabbed a bottle, there is a table out here in the Narthex, and you can sign up to take one of those, and you can return it anytime during May. The Bridge Street Mission Sober Living House is looking for volunteers to help prepare and serve food. If you are interested in being part of that, please speak with Carrie Kafal, and there's more information in your bulletin on that. There is, next Sunday, there's going to be a planned giving workshop that will be taught by Kyle Nolan from the Presbyterian Foundation, and they'll be talking to you about estate planning, so feel free to join in on that. There is Walking in the Light puppet event at Highland Church in Wausau, Sunday, May 21st. It's at 6 p.m. The puppets have come and performed for us here at the church, and is always a big highlight for the kids and families, so feel free to join them for that. And just a last note, Abby Frieza is going to be joining as a summer intern, and we're really excited to have her join us, and you'll be hearing more about that in the coming weeks. Now let's prepare to feed our spirits as we worship together.
Good morning, church. It's good to be together this morning as we are celebrating Mother's Day and also continuing in our conversation on the life of Joseph. We are going to pick up this morning in Genesis chapter 42. And so our call to worship is going to be just the first five verses of that chapter. Listen for God's word. When Jacob learned that there was grain in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you keep looking at one another? I have heard," he said, "that there is grain in Egypt. Go down and buy grain for us there, that we may live and not die." So 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Joseph's brother Benjamin with his brothers, for he feared that harm might come to him. Thus the sons of Israel were among the other people who came to buy grain, for the famine had reached the land of Canaan. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you. our call to confession. Peter writes, "The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance." Thankful for God's patience, today we acknowledge our sin and confess it together. Lord Jesus, we know that there is much in our lives which we ought to have done or left undone this week. We confess all our shortcomings today. We have sinned. But today we wish to offer more than just a confession. Our desire is to demonstrate true repentance, to turn away from our old lives and turn towards you. Holy Spirit, equip us for the work of pivoting so that our path leads us in the direction of Christ. Lord God, thank you for patience and makes all repentance possible. Therefore, brothers and sisters, be all the more eager to confirm your call and election, for if you do this, you will never stumble. For in this way, entry into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will be richly provided for you. Believe the good news. Through faith in Jesus, we have entry into the kingdom of heaven, both in this life and in the life to come. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please be seated. I want you to know that the slides worked that whole time, but I told the team in the booth that you guys were getting soft. We needed some practices in the hymnal and the bulletin, so good job. Very proud of you. We have the privilege this morning of celebrating the sacrament of baptism, so I'm going to invite the Hawker family to come and join me up here in front of the church. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. And remember that I am with you always, even until the end of the age. Hear also these words from Holy Scripture. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show that we belong to him. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptisms as we celebrate this sacrament.
On behalf of the session, I present John Robert Hawker II, son of John and Natalie Hawker, to receive the sacrament of baptism.
John and Natalie, in presenting your son for baptism, you reaffirm your own faith. Now show that faith by answering these questions. Is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you renounce sin in your life and in the world?
Yes.
And you promise to raise your child in the Christian faith and teach him what it means to be Christ's disciple?
Yes.
And you desire for your son to be baptized?
Yes.
That's great. Would the congregation please be upstanding?
Do we, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture this new disciple of Jesus Christ, teaching him to obey all that Christ commands, and with our fellowship, to strengthen his ties with the household of God? If so, please say, we do.
We do. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift and the promise of baptism. We thank you that in these moments we are reminded that before we knew you, you knew and loved us. And while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We thank you for the reminder that you welcome us into your family as your beloved daughters and sons. We ask that your Holy Spirit would descend upon these waters and upon John and set them together aside for a holy and a sacramental purpose. We pray, Lord, that you would remind us today that all of us are set aside for your good work as your beloved children. This we pray in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. You can be seated. I'll meet you right up there. Okay, buddy.
Here we go.
Showtime. I know this is not going to be your most popular thing, but I'm your buddy. Oh, yeah, I'm your buddy. I know. I don't feel like your buddy right now. Yeah, all right. It's okay. What is the Christian name of your son? John Robert, child of the covenant. I understand, buddy. Yeah. I baptize you in the name of God the Father and of God the Son and of God the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, buddy. Yeah, I'm so sorry. Yeah, I know. Here you go. Back to Dad. There you go. Safety. Oh, look at that. That's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful thing. You did a great job, buddy. You did a great job. Hey, we're going to sing Jesus Loves Me. I don't think John's excited about me walking him around the room, but we're going to walk together. So we'll sing together one verse of Jesus Loves Me. You cannot forget this, are you? You're going to remember this day. First, this stranger, crazy guy poured water on my head. Then we did a parade. Very strange. Hey, let's stand together and affirm what it is that we have been baptized into as we affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. Christians, in whom do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty. Lasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Kids, come on up for the children's message. Come scoot in. Let's scoot together. Together. Come on up. Scoot together. Oops, sorry, hon. Okay. So today is something special. What is today?
Mother's Day.
Mother's Day. Good points, good points. Come on up, buddy. So today is Mother's Day, so I thought we'd do a little Bible trivia, and I have some questions. Perfect. So we have Mom's Bible trivia. So we got five. Let's see if we can do five for five. The first one, Sarah is the mother of who? Do you guys know? Isaac, Paul, or Moses? Do you remember? Keep guessing.
Isaac,
right? Is that right? Yes, Isaac. So Sarah is the mother of Isaac. Let's go to the next one. Okay, so Rachel is the mother of, and the grown-ups might know this one. Have you been listening? Is it Dan, Reuben, or Joseph, right? Joseph, right? Okay, this is an easier one. Let's go to an easy one. Mary is the mother of
Jesus.
There we go. That's a good one, right? How many more do I have? Okay, this one is my favorite because it's Stump the Pastor Day. Pastor Jim, Jochebed is the mother of?
Okay, in fairness to me, I didn't give the multiple choice options. Yeah.
No.
I know the answer now, but only because you told me.
So, Jochebed is the mother of Moses. And at first we didn't think, so there's a lot of women in the Bible who are not named. And so that's why we were having a joke, because her name is actually a couple chapters later in like this long, long genealogy. So read your genealogy. It brings out good fun facts. So, and then Elizabeth is the mother of, who do we think this is? David, John the Baptist, or Peter?
David.
You think it's David? Let's keep guessing. John the Baptist, right? John the Baptist, yes. So today, obviously, it's, I have a saying, it says that mothers are the best, right? Dad is cool, but mothers are the best. So you have a challenge to spend some time with your mama today and think of all the mamas that were in the Bible and just thank God that your mama is not in the Bible, because the Jochebed that we were talking about put her baby in a basket and floated him down the river. Do you think Miss Natalie will do that with that baby? No, I don't think so. And he was smaller than that. So you go up to your mamas today and say, I am so glad that we are not in the Bible, right? Because you're not going to float me down the river today, okay? So let's say a prayer and then we can head to worship. Dear God, we are grateful for our moms and the history of women that have listened to you. God, we pray that you give them an extra special blessing today as we appreciate the people in our lives who have gone ahead of us in our faith and also are such a great example of our faith for us. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, so you guys can head down to kids' worship.
And as our kids make their way down, this is a great time to please stand and turn and greet your neighbors.
Thank you.
Our Old Testament passage this morning is on page 39 of the front part of your Bible. We're going to finish off Genesis chapter 42. As a reminder, last week, Joseph was exalted by Pharaoh to the right hand of the throne of Egypt, and he is now responsible for all of the grain collection and distribution. There's going to be 7 years of plenty and then 7 years of famine. In the beginning of our story, we are into that 7 years of famine, and the world is coming to Egypt to find and buy food from Joseph. Remember also that Joseph had a dream many, many chapters ago, his first dream from God, that his brothers would appear before him and bow down before him. And so we're going to see that dream fulfilled in our story today. One last detail between that dream and his exaltation to the right hand of Pharaoh, Joseph was betrayed by his brothers, almost murdered by them, sold into slavery by them, and taken away into Egypt, into exile. It has been 13 years since Joseph and his brothers have seen each other. And so we pick up in Genesis chapter 42, verse 6. Now Joseph was governor over the land. It was he who sold to all the people of the land. And Joseph's brothers came and bowed themselves before him with their faces to the ground. When Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them, but he treated them like strangers and spoke harshly to them. "Where do you come from?" he said. They said, "From the land of Canaan to buy food." Although Joseph had recognized his brothers, they did not recognize him. Joseph also remembered the dreams that he had dreamed about them. He said to them, "You are spies. You have come to see the nakedness of the land." They said to him, "No, my lord, your servants have come to buy food. We are all sons of one man. We are honest men. Your servants have never been spies." But he said to them, "No, you have come to see the nakedness of the land." They said, "We, your servants, are 12 brothers, the sons of a certain man in the land of Canaan. The youngest, however, is with our father, and one is no more." But Joseph said to them, "It is just as I have said to you, you are spies. Here is how you shall be tested. As Pharaoh lives, you shall not leave this place unless your youngest brother comes here. Let one of you go and bring your brother, while the rest of you remain in prison, in order that your words may be tested, whether there is truth in you. Or else, as Pharaoh lives, surely you are spies." And he put them all together in prison for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph said to them, "Do this and you will live, for I fear God. If you are honest men, let one of your brothers stay here where you are imprisoned. The rest of you shall go and carry grain for the famine of your households, and bring your youngest brother to me. Thus your words will be verified and you shall not die." And they agreed to do so. They said to one another, "Alas, we are paying the penalty for what we did to our brother. We saw his anguish when he pleaded with us, but we would not listen. That is why this anguish has come upon us." Then Reuben answered them, Reuben, the oldest of the boys, "Did I not tell you to not wrong the boy? But you would not listen. So now there comes a reckoning for his blood." They did not know that Joseph understood them, since he spoke with them through an interpreter. He turned away from them and wept. Then he returned and spoke to them. And he picked out Simeon and had him bound before their eyes. Joseph then gave orders to fill their bags with grain, to return every man's money to his sack, and to give them provisions for their journey. This was done for them. They loaded their donkeys with their grain and departed. When one of them opened his sack to give his donkey fodder at the lodging place, he saw his money at the top of the sack. He said to his brothers, "My money has been put back. Here it is in my sack." At this they lost heart and turned trembling to one another, saying, "What is this that God has done to us?" When they came back to their father Jacob in the land of Canaan, they told him all that had happened to them, saying, "The man, the lord of the land, spoke harshly to us and charged us with spying on the land. But we said to him, 'We are honest men, we are not spies, we are 12 brothers, sons of one father. One is no more, and the youngest is now with our father in the land of Canaan.' Then the man, the lord of the land, said to us, 'By this I shall know that you are honest men. Leave one of your brothers with me. Take grain for the famine of your households, and go your way. Bring your youngest brother to me, and I shall know that you are not spies, but honest men. Then I will release your brother to you, and you may trade in the land." As they were emptying their sacks, there in each one's sack was his bag of money. When they and their father saw the bundles of money, they were dismayed. And their father Jacob said to them, "I am the one you have bereaved of children. Joseph is no more, and Simeon is no more, and now you would take Benjamin. All this has happened to me." Then Reuben said to his father, "You may kill my two sons if I do not bring him back to you. Put him in my hands, and I will bring him back to you." But he said, "My son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he alone is left. If harm should come to him on the journey that you are to make, he would bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to Sheol." Let's continue to worship. Our New Testament passage this morning is going to be in the second letter of Peter in the third chapter, beginning with the third verse, page 238 of your pew Bible, if you want to follow along as we read. Peter is addressing what in many ways is the central question of the New Testament church. When is Jesus coming back? And his answer is one that we have been talking about for quite a long time. Listen for God's word. First of all, you must understand this, that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and indulging their own lusts and saying, "Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since our ancestors died, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation." They deliberately ignore this fact, that by the word of God, heavens existed long ago, and an earth was formed out of water and by means of water, through which the world of that time was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word, the present heavens and earth have been reserved for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the godless. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You know of my love of all things historical and of context. And so I thought it'd be fun to do a little bit of context about Mother's Day this year. Mother's Day actually began in its present version in the 1900s, but it had a precursor. And the original version of Mother's Day was actually founded by a woman named Julia Ward Howe. And I've got a picture of Mrs. Howe. Can we just leave that up for a few minutes? Julia Ward Howe was born in the 1800s. She was a poet and an author and an advocate for women's and African-American suffrage. Really an amazing woman, devout Christian. Later in life, she also became a peace advocate after the end of the Civil War. She presided over the Women's International Peace Association in 1871 and was known as the dearest old lady in America, which I think is a good thing. And she helped launch something that she called the Mother's Peace Day. The Mother's Peace Day was launched in 1872 on June 2nd, and it was celebrated every June 2nd from 72 to 1913. And it was an opportunity for everyone, mothers, women, everyone, to gather in churches and social halls and homes and to listen to sermons or essays and sing and pray for peace. And this happened in Boston and New York and Philadelphia and Chicago, and it was quite a significant deal until around 1913 when the movement began to fade away and as the world entered into World War I. This is a really interesting idea, this Mother's Peace Day, this idea that perhaps part of the purpose of this day might not just be to celebrate mothers, but also to recognize that somehow we all share something in common. We all have this common humanity that binds us together back to one mother and one father in the beginning of the story of Scripture. And perhaps that in this story, we might have a holiday focused on more than just cards, flowers, and chocolate. This morning, we sang the least peaceful hymn I know. We sang the Battle Hymn of the Republic, right? This was actually written during the Civil War, and it became kind of the anthem for the Union. Do me a favor, because we made you practice this morning, pull out a hymnal for a minute and look up hymn number, I believe it's 354, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory." 354, yep. And look at the bottom left-hand corner of that hymn, and somebody tell me who wrote the words. Hey, it's Julia Ward Howe. Julia Ward Howe actually wrote this as a poem that was published in 1861, and then ultimately became the hymn that we know and sing today. It's really interesting to me that our most militant hymn was written by a woman who became the leader of the Mother's Peace Day movement. And it strikes me that those things are not entirely incongruous, that there may be times when we are called to oppose those who are perpetrating injustice. There may be times when we're called to oppose those who are leading themselves or others down a dark path. And sometimes that might even mean that we oppose them by force of arms. But even when we do so, as Christians, we are to recognize that they are not our enemies, that they are not evil, they are just being used by evil. And that God's great desire for our earthly opponents is that they might become, once again, our earthly sisters and brothers. That our real battle is not with flesh and blood, but with the cosmic powers of this present darkness, with the spiritual forces of evil and the heavenly realms. And that means everybody else is a potential sister and brother if we can find our way to the peace of God that He designed us to be a part of. If we can find our way back to being the one family under the one Father that God designed us to be. In so many ways, I think that is the story of Joseph today. He's not a mother, I get it. But it is the story of a movement from seeing our earthly opponents as evil to seeing them as those used by evil, those sisters and brothers that we hope to be reunited with under God's peace. So Joseph does some weird stuff to his brothers in this story. And you noticed a lot of it, right? Joseph, first of all, I mean, I get not immediately revealing himself, but he pretends to not know them. He speaks through an interpreter to pretend he doesn't know their language. And he starts accusing them of things immediately. You guys are spies. You're here to see where everything is and rob us blind. And then he imprisons them for 3 days. And then he says, hey, you have to bring your youngest brother back and leave one other brother here while you go get him as collateral. And then, and the weirdest thing that he does as they leave, he has his servants put their money back in their bags. So when they open up their bags to get the food that they bought, there's their money again, which seems obviously problematic. And the whole time I'm reading this story, I'm thinking about a song. I'm not going to sing it. I'm thinking about a song by the band Foreigner called Head Games. Anybody know this song? Last week I hummed part of the A-Team theme and I got a lot of grief for that. So I'm not going to sing Foreigner. But it feels like Head Games, right? It feels like Joseph is just playing with their minds, right? Messing with them to get back at them for all they did to him. But I don't believe that to be the case. In fact, I think Joseph is doing something incredibly profound and important on a really simple human level and then on a spiritual level as well. So on a human level, on a very basic concept, I believe Joseph is trying to save the life of his brother Benjamin. Okay? Joseph, remember, has one full brother and he has 10 half-brothers. Benjamin is his only full brother, the son of his mother and his father. And Benjamin, Joseph might assume, is in deadly peril from his other 10 siblings, right? The other 10 siblings that got rid of Joseph because he was the favored son. Joseph assumes, correctly it appears in our story, that the favor of Jacob has now fallen on Joseph's only full brother, Benjamin. And as his brothers tried to kill him, so they might try to kill Benjamin. And so I think behind everything that Joseph does in this story is the simple idea that he wants to save the life of his youngest brother. The only way he can do that is by making them bring Benjamin to him in Egypt. And so we have this complicated story that results in the brothers needing to preserve Benjamin's life and deliver him safely to Joseph in Egypt. By the way, I think even Jacob is worried about Benjamin's life. Did you notice that? Jacob doesn't send his son Benjamin with the other 10 siblings because he's afraid that harm might befall him. So on a really simple level, as head gamey as it seems, I believe Joseph's just trying to rescue his brother. But there's a much deeper level that's happening in this story as well. I think Joseph, this is ironic for something that happens in chapter 50, but I think Joseph is in the place of God in this story. I think we're supposed to read this story as though Joseph is acting towards his brothers as God acts towards us. And in this role, in this reading, with Joseph in the place of God, we see a purpose behind all of his actions. Joseph is trying to lead his brothers to repentance. It's been 13 years since they've seen each other. And in those 13 years, a lot has changed for Joseph. I do not believe that as I read this story, Joseph is acting with anger or in a punitive sense. I think Joseph is trying to bring his brothers out of their own darkness and back into his family to be a family of peace again. So we get some clues to this. We get, first of all, Joseph remembering the dreams he dreamed about them. Joseph was given these dreams by God at the beginning of a story, and when he remembers them in this moment, he is remembering that this has all been part of God's plan. That this whole crazy series of events, as awful, as horrific as it was that he went through, from attempted murder by his brothers, to being sold into slavery, to being imprisoned, to being forgotten, all of that was somehow going to lead to this redemptive moment where the world is saved through Joseph. Joseph is seeing that happen now. And so when he remembers his dreams, it's not like God remembering Noah and his promises to Noah in the midst of the flood. It's not like God remembering Abraham and his promises to Abraham that he would have a child through his wife Sarah. Joseph remembers the promises of God. But then his response to his brothers is really to call them out, right? You are spies. He doesn't call them out and say, hey, I am Joseph and you are in trouble. Because at that moment, there's no way for real repentance. Now, imagine if in this moment, Joseph said, hey, 13 years ago, remember that when you tried to murder your brother and then sold him into slavery? It's me. They're not going to say, well, we'd do it again in a heartbeat if we could. They're going to say, oh, gosh, you are like the boss man now, so we're going to pretend that we really feel bad about this. So what Joseph needs is not forced repentance. He wants genuine repentance. By the way, this is what God wants from us, right? Could God make you repent? Of course he could. Could God show up in your life at this moment and speak with a thundering voice and list everything you've ever done wrong and tell you what you should have done instead? Of course he could. And would you say, I'm sorry? Of course you would. And would it mean anything? No, not at all. Right? You're just doing it because you're scared, because the boss man tells you. So Joseph says, I want to find a way for them to have real repentance. So he makes up this story, says you're spies, puts them in prison, then says, bring your youngest brother back to me. And then he says, I'm going to keep one of your brothers here. And in all of this, we get this sense of fear, right, that the brothers must be feeling. And they actually say this in verse 21. They say, alas, we are paying the penalty for what we did to our brother. We saw his anguish when he pleaded with us, but we would not listen. This is why this anguish has come upon us. It's interesting, they actually connect it, right? I mean, they actually on their own connect the bad things happening to them to the bad thing that they have done. But it's significant that recognition is not repentance. Recognition is not repentance, though it may be the beginning of repentance. C.S. Lewis speaks about this kind of behavior of God. He says, we can ignore even pleasure, but pain insists on being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. No doubt pain as God's megaphone is a terrible instrument. It may lead to final and unrepented rebellion, but it gives the only opportunity the bad man can have for amendment. It removes the veil. It plants the flag of truth within the fortress of the rebel soul. Lewis's point is not that every bad thing that happens to us happens because God is trying to teach us a lesson, okay? So get rid of that idea for a moment. Instead, he wants to say that sometimes God is left with no other option but to try to wake us up through the megaphone of his pain. And I think that's what Joseph is doing to his brothers. I think we do this all the time, right? As parents, we do this. Mothers, you've done this a lot, right? I want to teach you this behavior is not appropriate, so I will use the megaphone of pain. I will put you in timeout. I will take away your cell phone. I will cancel your extracurriculars. I will not let you go out. I will set a curfew. You are grounded, right? Why do we do those things? Because we hope that a little bit of pain now might save them from a world of pain later. We hope that a little bit of self-reflection now might cause them to not go into that pattern of behavior that we worry about so much. When we are parenting well, the purpose of punishment is not punitive. It's redemptive. It's to bring our kids back to peace. We've had this conversation before in regards to people dealing with addiction. We often talk about interventions as a way to raise up the rock bottom, right? Everybody's got to hit rock bottom before they change, we often say, but you can raise up the rock bottom. Let's not make it a hospital visit. Let's not make it overdosing. Let's make it a really uncomfortable conversation with the family. Because if we can raise up the rock bottom, if we can use that megaphone, we might reach them and bring them to some recognition. That's not all that's accomplished in this story. It's not just that there is a recognition of their sin. We get this really interesting account of Reuben's speech to his brothers. Reuben, the oldest of the brothers of the 12, is the only one who has had more or less a positive perspective. Reuben is the one who said, don't murder Joseph, back in chapter 37. Reuben is the one who said, I'm going to come back and free him later. He fails, but he plans on doing it. And here, Reuben says, hey, didn't I tell you? Didn't I tell you not to sin against our brother? And if you had listened to me, this would not be happening. Reuben says, hey, I recognize that there's a reckoning for his blood. There's a reckoning for his blood. And I think there is this implication that we've moved beyond just recognition to remorse. Remorse is great. Remorse is not repentance. But it's an important step on the road to repentance. And it's striking to me that in this moment, Joseph runs off and weeps. And not the only time in our story this is going to happen, but in this chapter, it's the only moment that Joseph is so overwhelmed by emotion that he has to turn away and cry and then come back. And I think, again, Joseph is in the place of God here. We know that the process of repentance is a cause for incredible emotion in God. Jesus says there is more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who don't need to repent. So I think at this moment, we see God's overwhelming emotion in those moments when we are moving back towards him, when we are taking those first steps on the road to repentance. But, and this is really important, remorse is not repentance. Confession isn't repentance either. Though they don't quite confess their sin here, we see the beginnings of it. Repentance is more than all of that. It is a true turning away from an old life into a new life with God. So we get one more weird story. We get the money in their sacks. Joseph sends them off. He puts their money that they bought their food with back in their sacks, and he sends them off home. And this is the most head-gamey of all of the things that Joseph does. I get it. I see it. But the response is really striking. So the first brother, whoever it is, opens up his sack and finds the money there. And then we get this really important response. We're told that he looks to his brothers and he says, "What is this that God has done to us? What is this that God has done to us?" And the way he says this is significant. We've been talking about some of these themes that run throughout Genesis, and there's a question that keeps getting asked in the book of Genesis. It's the question, "What this?" Anybody for bonus points today remember how to say "what this" in Hebrew? No bonus points. I got somebody. Oh, come on. You know it? Mazot. Oh, bonus points. Well done. Okay. So we've had this question again and again. God speaking to the serpent after the sin in the garden. Mazot. What this? What have you done? Pharaoh speaking to Abraham after discovering that Abraham sold his wife into essentially sexual slavery to Pharaoh. Mazot. What is this you've done? Every time we've heard this phrase, it's almost always been someone in the position of God speaking to someone in the position of the serpent, asking them what they were doing. Here for the first time in Genesis, we have the same people in both roles. We have people that are the seed of the serpent looking to each other and saying, "What this? Mazot." Right? In the role of God, and in the role of the serpent, they're both. And this is an incredibly important, huge moment in the story of Scripture. It is possible for those who are living like the seed of the serpent to become the seed of the woman. It is possible for those who are living a life of selfishness and self-centeredness to be transformed, to be changed. What it requires is this idea of repentance. It requires this transformation. It requires a turning around of our lives that begins with recognition and remorse and confession, but leads to some kind of action. It leads to some kind of action that people do. There's a band called Caveman's Call, and they have a song that I love. And in that song, there's a line, "You can lead a horse to water, you can even make him drink, but you can't change his point of view." And this is God with us. This is Joseph with his brothers. We can be led to water. We can be forced to drink. But repentance is when our point of view is changed, when our life is turned around, when we finally begin to make sense and become someone different. And we get one little bit of this story as well. And it's the weirdest part of this whole story, and this is a weird chapter. Did you notice the end thing that Reuben says to his dad? Super creepy, right? Reuben says, "Hey, Dad, I'll take Benjamin down to this weird guy in Egypt, and I'll deliver him there, and I'll bring him back safely. And if I don't bring him back safely, here are my two sons, your grandchildren. Feel free to kill them off so that, you know, if I don't bring your son back." And I've been thinking about this a lot this week. I've been thinking, hopefully no one ever in the history of time thought this was a good idea, right? And so I'm thinking, this is just Jim Gates. Maybe this is like an idiom, you know? Like maybe just something you said back in the day, like, "Hey, you know what? If I don't show up to session meeting on time, you can kill Jonathan and Asher all you want," right? And I think maybe this is not a good idiom. So I'm going to encourage you to not bring it back. Bob, Melanie, I don't encourage you to say, "Hey, you know, if we screw up and don't show up for Sunday school on time, you can take out little John." That's not a good idea, okay? But in the weirdness of this moment, Reuben's trying to repent. Reuben's trying to say, "Hey, I'm going to turn around. I'm going to walk away from that old life and walk towards God." Now, we'll talk about this more next week. Reuben isn't the one that needs to repent, and so it doesn't change the story yet. But in that moment, we get a glimpse, a weird glimpse of what it might mean to walk away from our sin and walk towards Jesus. And it raises the question for us, right? Where are we in this story? Are we like the brothers, aware of some kind of brokenness in our life that's been there maybe for weeks or months? Maybe it's Maybe it's some kind of brokenness that's been in our life for 13 years. And we're not quite ready to make a change. Maybe God is shouting in our pain. Maybe God is trying to raise up the rock bottom of our life so that we can be spared a fate worse than death. Maybe we need to begin on that path of recognition and remorse and confession and repentance. Or maybe we're in the place of Joseph today. Maybe in your life, there is someone who is not deserving of forgiveness. Maybe in your life, there's someone who has sinned against you in such a profound and painful way that there is nothing they could ever do to make it right again. Maybe you are supposed to be in the place of Joseph, in the place of God, and offer forgiveness that cannot be earned or deserved. That is just grace. This is an interesting story because it takes 13 years to get this right. And it strikes me that often in our lives, this process of repentance is really slow and hard. And so I come back to this beautiful passage in 2 Peter, where Peter is speaking to the people about the question of time. When is God going to come back? When is Jesus going to show up? When are we going to fix this messed up world? We got a war in Ukraine. We got war in South Sudan and Sudan. We got hunger, and we got hurricanes, and we got famine, and we have violence. We have all these things filling up our world. When is Jesus going to come back and make this right? And what is he waiting for? And Peter says, the Lord is not slow about his promise, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. The story of Scripture is a story of a patient God who will come. Scripture says, the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. He will come, he will make the world right, but at the moment, God is waiting patiently, hoping that we might come to repentance, that we, like Joseph's brothers, might recognize our broken lives and trust that God could do something different, that we, like Joseph, might recognize our brothers are not our enemies, and that we are called to march forward in peace. There's a great little book called Ender's Shadow, and part of a larger series of books, and in it, there's a sister, a Catholic nun, who says, do you know why Satan is so angry all the time? Because whenever he works a particularly clever bit of mischief, God uses it to serve his own righteous purposes. In this conversation, another person speaks up and says, so God uses wicked people as his tools? She says, God gives us the freedom to do great evil if we choose. Then he uses his own freedom to create goodness out of that evil, for that is always what he chooses. So in the long run, God always wins? Yes. In the short run, though, it can be uncomfortable. We are those people in the midst of the short run. And in this season of our lives, it may be uncomfortable to offer repentance or offer forgiveness as God does for us. But be patient with others, for the Lord is patient with you. Listen for his voice, whispering, speaking, and shouting to you. And remember that your time is not infinite, that Christ will return, that the world will be made right one day, but until then, it is our call, it is our work to invite the world on this day and every day back to being one family, back to being a people of peace. May it be so, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
Every year, we take a Sunday to celebrate our music teams and the blessing of their worship leadership for us. And so I'm going to invite Deb to say a few words on this Music Appreciation Sunday.
Good morning. On Music Appreciation Sunday, it is appropriate to thank all of our talented musicians and vocalists for sharing their gift with us here at Covenant Community Presbyterian Church. Thank you. Thank you to the adult choir, the handbell choir, Voices of Glory, Covenant Faith Singers, Men of Praise, those who provide special music, our accompanists, and additional musicians. Thank you also to those who are involved with the music at the 6 p.m. service. We are so blessed to have all of you. I'm so glad that you are all here and that you all participate. Please stand if you are currently involved in any way in our music program here at Covenant Community Presbyterian. Please stand. I think there's a few shy people. Please stand if you have ever been involved with the music program, not just currently, but ever. Please look around. We are so blessed that we have the people who are willing to share their gifts and their talents with us. May I please have a round of applause for our people? Thank you.
We give thanks to God for our musicians, and we give thanks to God for the gift of their music leadership and worship leadership for us. As we come to this table today for prayer, we also want to continue to give thanks for those for whom this is a special and wonderful day of celebration. We're also reminded that for some, this is a challenging day, for those who have lost mothers, for those who are unable to have their own children. And so we pray that they also might feel God's special love and grace today. We also want to give thanks for two of our newest mothers this week. Christy and Taylor Smith had their daughter Amelia, and last week, Abby and Zach Knetter had their son Wesley, and so we give thanks for the birth of Amelia and Wesley, and then of course we give thanks for the baptism of John, who is out like a light. Love it. Love it. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that you have made us one family. We thank you that through the work of Jesus, through the gift of baptism, through the indwelling of your Spirit, you have made us again what you always desired us to be. So we pray that as one family, we might somehow today invite others into this family and into this story. We thank you for the additions of John through baptism and Amelia and Wesley, and we thank you for those who have offered forgiveness and those who have taken the courageous steps of repentance, and for your patience with us and for those who have been patient with us. We thank you, Lord, that this journey is one that you are so passionate about. You are so excited about our returning to your family and to each other, that there is rejoicing in heaven every time one of us turns our life back to you. So we want to do that today, Lord. We want to be the cause of your celebration. We want to be the cause of great joy for you. We give you thanks for those who have blessed us in that journey. Particularly, we pray and thank you for our mothers and those who have loved us and shown us what love looks like. And we pray, Lord, for those for whom this day is a great day of celebration, that they would celebrate well. We pray for those for whom this is a day of challenge or pain, that they would feel your love and grace in the midst of all of it. And we thank you, Lord, that we cannot lose the gift of our family. No matter what comes, even death itself cannot separate us from each other or from you. And that soon and very soon, we will be united again. And as we wait for that day, we pray with confidence and hope the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
we get to give back to God today in some important ways. We'd love for you to take a minute and fill out your connection card. Let us know that you're here. That's a big help for us. We want to celebrate your presence. On the back of that card, we'd love the privilege of being in prayer for you. So if you have a need for prayer, please let us know on the back of that card. If you're worshiping with us online, you can do all that right there on the website. We also get to give back to God with our tithes and our additional offerings. And so we will, in a minute, have our ushers come forward and they'll collect our offerings and our prayers and our cards as we continue to worship. I'm really excited. Next week, we have Pastor Kyle Nolan coming to us from the Presbyterian Foundation. He'll be in worship briefly during the worship service, and then after the service next Sunday, he's going to do a little seminar on planned giving in Bolden Hall. So if you want to learn more about the process of considering including the church in your will, or just how important it is to have a will, something like, I forgot, it's like 60% of Americans don't have a will. It's crazy. Come and hear Kyle speak about that and really the theology behind our stewardship. I think it's going to be a really neat conversation. You don't have to sign up. You can just show up next Sunday and join us in Bolden Hall. There'll be food there, so food is always good. Also, if you have not done so already, we'd love for you to pick up a baby bottle from the Narthex. This is our Ministry to Support Hope Life Center, which is designed to help mothers keep their kids. We believe there are no unwanted children in the kingdom of God. And so we hope that you will help by taking one of these home, putting some change or dollars or checks, whatever you want, in there, and then bring this back, and we will take all those gifts to Hope Life Center and help them with their ministry. Last but not least, if you're here for the first time, we have a gift for you. It's a book by John Ortberg. It's a short little read. It's a great read. What is God's Will for My Life? If you want to know what God wants you to do with your life, pick up this book. It's worth reading. They are in the Narthex right outside of our sanctuary, and you can grab one after the service. There's also Bibles there. If you don't have a Bible, we want you to have one. Please take one off that table as a thank you for being with us. Now, sisters and brothers, I pray this week, as you go about your week, you would have the privilege of recognizing those places in which God is being patient with you. And you would have the privilege of standing in the place of God to be patient with another, in the hopes that we might all come to repentance and be united again in the family and the peace of God. And as you go about your week, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.